When people think of great artists or where artists are flourishing, sometimes the thoughts come up of Seattle, Washington, Oakland, California, places like that. But I'm here to argue today that Perry County, Kentucky is just as vital and just as important. In fact, I have a great example here, Katie Davison, student from Perry County Central, on today's art workshop. Thank you all so much for tuning in today to the Art Workshop. I'm really excited about today's episode. We have Katie Davison from Perry County with us today. We're going to be looking at her processes. She's a senior at Perry Central High School. And when I first visited, you know, the counties, I go to a lot of schools, and I've mentioned this before on the show. I talk to a lot of students. I see a lot of students' work, and Katie's work really stood out to me from the first time I met her. And so it's such a thrill and excitement to be able to share with all the students and all the folks watching the art workshop today, Katie's work. Katie, welcome to the art workshop.
Well, hello there. It's good that you're having me here.
Well, it's an honor to have you. And like I was telling everybody, you are from Perry County, right? And you go to Perry Central High School.
Yes, I do.
And you're a senior.
Yep.
Right? Well, it's a thrill to have you here. And we're going to be doing a few different things today. Folks that pay attention to the show and they watch the show, they understand we have more of it's a tutorial-based type show where we show folks different techniques and drawing. And then we have student showcases like today where we actually look at a student's work and we highlight that work. And we talk about your processes, too, because there's a lot of students out there who are watching this show who are interested in drawing. Okay, and they want to know more about how things are put together. And you've mastered a few things, in my opinion, that I think students should be able to have access to. Okay?
All right,
cool. So first, I think we should start off by talking a little bit about yourself. Mm-hmm. Okay, so tell me a little bit about what your influences are with art.
Ever since I was little, I lost my mom when I was 12, and I had a friend named Christina, and I know she drew a lot. And I wanted to get in on that, so I let her start teaching me. And in high school, they actually offered classes. And so I started taking the classes, and I was introduced to Miss Lisa Holland and Miss Melissa Brashear. And they kind of took me under their wings, and they taught me everything I know up to this point, and they've influenced me all the way through to get to this point.
Oh, that's great. Yeah, you know, the thing, I can relate to that, actually. You know, I lost my mother and brother back-to-back, and that really kind of put me back into art. Mm-hmm. So at the time, I went back to, I remember back in high school when I was your age, and I would draw a lot. And it really helps, doesn't it?
Mm-hmm.
When you throw yourself and you actually work on this stuff, at that time, when you're producing it, it helps to just to deal with stuff. And sometimes, and you know what? Your talent has, the time you've put into your work shows.
Yeah.
Okay? And I think that's one of the biggest missing pieces with folks out there. They think when they see artwork that's done well, that people do it overnight, and it doesn't happen that way.
Oh,
does it?
Yeah.
There's a lot of practice. There's a lot of planning. There's a lot of time put into this, right?
Yeah.
Okay. Let me ask you a couple more questions before we actually look at your work. Tell the audience a little bit about the types of work you like to look at. Any favorite artists at all?
I got a few favorite artists. They're not really well known. They're more like people I find on the internet, people that I've seen. But I do love Van Gogh. Not only his artwork, but his lifestyle I thought was really interesting. I always saw him as someone who was really cool. I actually taught the grade schoolers about him when I got to go teach them. And I dressed up as him. It was pretty fun.
Very cool.
And I always liked fantasy artwork, like making up really intricate characters with detailed backgrounds about worlds that aren't this one, because I always thought it was really cool to make your own little place.
Oh, that's awesome. And Van Gogh, for everybody, he's the artist that cut off his ear, right?
Mm-hmm.
I don't think he sold, I think he sold one painting when
he
was alive. That was
one.
It. But now Van Gogh's are worth a lot of money.
Oh, yeah.
His original pieces are worth a ton of money. Okay, so that's really cool. And you mentioned something that stood out while we're discussing this just then. You create characters with these immense backgrounds.
Yes.
So not only are you drawing a character, but you are actually creating a story behind that character as you produce it, right? So here's an example, and we're going to go to the overhead in a second, and we're going to look at this and see it more in detail. And this is a character that Katie created. This is from, I call it a series, but you might not call it, it's a fawn.
Yes.
And we're going to talk about what a fawn is in a little bit for everybody as we're looking at your work in more detail. Mm-hmm. And I guess we should probably just go ahead and look at your work a little bit more, if that's okay. So the fawn is a creature. It's a mythological creature. And tell us a little bit about this piece.
I didn't really create the original species of the fawn. I had seen them on Google, and I kind of, when I was little, watched Narnia, and that inspired me a lot because I thought Thomas, the little satyr-looking dude, was the coolest thing I'd ever seen. And so I started really getting into that, and I realized there was ones with deers. And I was like, okay, that's really cool.
So fawns are half human and half some other animal.
Yeah.
And I know a lot of folks in the viewing audience has watched Narnia and the Chronicles of Narnia. They've read the books probably too.
Mm-hmm.
And so I think the character Thomas in Narnia is a goat.
Yeah, goat, that's a satyr, and those are usually like half goat or half sheep, and then the fawns are more on like the deer and elk side of it.
Oh, that is so cool. And tell us a little bit about the media you used here to create this with.
This was watercolor and some markers that I have, but it was, all this I believe was marker, and then the background was all watercolor that I used, and I used a white gel pen to go back in to add the little small details, if you can see them.
Oh, absolutely. That's something that's almost like a trend with your stuff, is that you'll create something in color and then you go back with this detail in white, right?
Mm-hmm.
And it's beautiful. It's amazing. And if you want to know, I'm kind of guessing at this too for everybody at home, I'm guessing that you watercolored this background and then you painted ink on top of that, right?
Yeah.
Okay, so you weren't trying to color around each little black line for the trees.
No,
right?
It's better to go and do the background first.
Okay, I've seen students do that before, and mm-hmm. I'm like, you know, so
it's
much
like,
easier.
Don't do it.
All right, so you want to go ahead and move on to the next example you brought for us today?
I do like pen and ink, so
just
this
Look
is Sam and Dean from the show Supernatural, if you watch it.
It's a television show.
Yeah, it's a pretty good show, but I wanted to do some pen and ink drawings of them.
It's amazing, yeah.
That's another watercolor I did. This was inspiration from a blind owl that I saw. His eyes look just like galaxies, and so I called this Zeus.
Zeus. Could we go back for a second to your pen and ink drawing, just for a second? For those at home, we talked about this once upon a time, crosshatching.
Mm-hmm.
You want to talk a little bit about what crosshatching is for us a little bit?
It's one of my favorite things in the world, really. And crosshatching is, with my pen and ink drawings, is what I normally use it on. You go one direction, and then you go in the opposite direction in multiple lines, and it gets you a shading effect.
Now this, you've noticed that these lines are going in one direction, so but cross-hatching, and you're absolutely right, it can also be lines just close together too, right? Like how you've done here for this shading. This is amazing. This is
Thank you.
Wonderfully done. Okay, let's go back to the owl inspired piece. Now you notice the lips, it's unreal.
Thank you.
Your talents is just... It blows me away. When I first saw your characters done, what hit me the most, I think, was your control. And when I mean by control, that just means you're able to use something well, was your control of color.
Thank you.
You're using primarily what to color this here?
That was all watercolor, I think. And I think the only thing that's not watercolor might have been this gold acrylic that I spattered on it.
And you do this a lot, too. Like, you'll finish mm-hmm. a piece, I noticed, and then you'll add these really cool details. The spotting, sometimes the points with the white. It's wonderful.
Now I just want to add freckles because I can, and they seem like fun at the time.
Well, why not, right?
Yeah, it's like freckles are cool.
It's your creation. It's awesome. All right, so we'll go ahead and jump to the next piece.
That's another character version of the fawn you just saw. I kind of put war paint on them this time.
Very cool. You know what this kind of reminds me of, and I hope you don't. Avatar?
Oh, yeah, I love Avatar. I always thought it was a cool
movie.
Avatar?
Mm-hmm. You are? Because you notice, like, the characters, they have a lot of color, and then whenever they go to war, they do the similar thing, don't they?
Yeah.
They prepare for war like that. Very cool. And you have a fairy here, has noticed?
Yeah, it's a little small one, and it came out a little weird, but I was like, whatever, just put some gold on there.
Is this your own creation, then?
Yeah.
Did this character have a name?
Yeah, his name is Lazarus.
Lazarus? Very cool.
He is the king of the fawns.
And I kind of see the scars across his eye, too. So you can tell so much from an image. An image can tell you 1,000 stories if you look at it right. For instance, I'm going to kind of go on a rant here for a minute, Katie. With this image, what I can see, and this is the first time I think I saw this. I may have glimpsed that a little bit while I visited your school.
Yeah.
But this character has obviously been in war before, or fight, or battle, or struggle, okay? You can tell that by the artifacts that's adorning the ear, that there is culture to this creature. This is culture to this character. And then also with, you can see inspiration even, one would say even, I don't know, maybe this character's own mythology with the fairies too, right?
Yep.
There's a relationship between the fairies and the fauns, which I think is true in mythology, isn't it? That there is a relationship.
They usually hang out together. They do a lot of mischief stuff.
Yeah. I'm going to shut up and let you talk more. I'm sorry. Okay, let's jump ahead to the next one.
This was kind of a fan art that I had done. I think the next two or three are actually fan art of Norman Reedus / Daryl.
Okay, what's fan art?
It's art that you do for a show or a book or a TV series that you like.
Okay, and in this sense, the show you're referencing is The Walking Dead, right? We probably have a lot of viewers who watch The Walking Dead and enjoy The Walking Dead. Daryl is, you know the character right off. So
yeah.
Tell us a little bit about this piece, how you did it, and what inspired you.
Well, me and my friend were talking about Daryl and how cool his jacket was with the wings, and I was like, wouldn't it be cool if they made a version of it where you were either an angel or a demon, and we thought that Daryl would be more on the fallen angel side because of all of his struggles. So I drew him as an angel, alone, trying to recuperate.
I love your use a lot in this. Is this Copic marker?
It's marker and watercolor with some golden ink.
Okay, so this is living proof that you can create an amazing piece when you combine medium, right? So you're combining watercolor, Copic markers, and then again, your highlighted special inks like in gold, right?
Yeah, that gold ink is like my favorite thing so far.
Okay, and this is the second fan art?
Yeah, it's Daryl again.
Oh, wow, that's so cool.
This one was if we were to have like a winter scene in The Walking Dead, which I don't know why we've not had yet. It should have been winter.
There's never been a winter scene.
No, it needs to be a winter scene, so I made it myself.
So it's very cool. I love it. And again, the culture, you can see even taking this character out of the show that it's in, the world it's in, and you created your own. It's really cool.
I always end up just being like, I'm going to make my own little world for you. And then this was a portrait practice I did just because I like his face. It's a good face to draw.
Yeah, awesome.
It's very interesting. He's got some features that aren't normal on faces, where he got in a car wreck when he was younger, so his nose is shaping different. One of his eyes are different, so it was really good practice to work with.
And was this a class assignment you had?
No, I was just bored.
Just bored. So so you're doing things, you're using terms like character draw, like what did you call this?
I called it a character study.
Okay, character study. Now, these are terms that are used in art classes, right?
Usually.
Yeah, and you're doing this at home.
Mm-hmm.
So students at home, you can kind of think of this as, Katie's assigning herself homework in this. But you're having fun. You love it.
Yeah.
Okay.
So I don't really do anything else. I'm just like, where's my sketchbook? I'm set for the next 4 months.
And we'll talk about sketchbooks here in a little bit, too. That's an important part of the process, isn't it? Oh, wow. This is
another one of my characters. Okay. It's Matthias, and he is a werewolf. And in my world, werewolves can never be fully human. Okay. And this is part four of his stages. And he actually helps Lazarus, because Lazarus is usually enemies with the werewolves, but Matthias is kicked out for reasons. And he goes to Lazarus' side.
Oh, very cool.
So they turn out to be friends.
Very cool.
And then,
this is awesome.
Yeah, this is a comic I did about Van Gogh, and when he goes out into the field, and the quote that I used is from him, and it says, "There may be a great fire in our hearts, yet no one comes to warm himself at it, and the passerbys will see only a wisp of smoke." And all of it's gray, but when he shoots himself in the field, which is what he ends up doing in his life, all the colors of his work come out and actually paint the field. And the last quote I used from him, it says, "It's easy to love. The only hard thing is to be loved."
Okay, this is incredible.
Thank you.
I heard about this, and I hadn't seen it till now.
Well, now you have.
And you know, the cool thing about this is that there's a lot of meaning behind this, obviously, right? You want to tell a little bit of the audience? We mentioned Van Gogh earlier in the show. We talked about him cutting off his ear.
Yeah.
We may should explain this a little more. So talk about this piece in a little bit, just kind of briefly about what it represents.
Well, we were going over Van Gogh in art class, and I love little Van Gogh, that poor thing. He never got enough love because everybody thought he was insane because they didn't have the medical stuff to help him out. They didn't have any medicine.
And we're talking what year was this?
I think like 1800s.
1800s.
1700s, something like that.
Like early 1800s, right?
So way back when.
There wasn't any psychiatrist walking around helping folks, right?
No, there was no medication. They just thought he was crazy, and they still don't know what was wrong with him to this day.
And there's a chance he might have had something, right? Like schizophrenia or something.
They're thinking that's it because he had really violent bouts of anger randomly.
Yeah, mental illness for sure in his life. Okay, go ahead. I'm sorry.
It's all right. We were going over him, and I don't know if you've watched it, but you need to look up the Doctor Who Van Gogh museum scene. It's the saddest, best thing you'll see in your life.
Okay.
They take him back in time and they bring him back to the future and show him, you know, everybody loves you. And he basically has a huge emotional breakdown in the middle of a museum as somebody explains how great he is.
As he's looking at his paintings on the
wall. Yeah, and he can't believe everybody actually likes his stuff. But whenever I drew it, I wanted everything gray except Van Gogh because everybody saw color and everything else, but he didn't because he was so depressed as his life went on because nobody wanted him. And he goes out in the field because at the end of his life, he had went out in the field and shot himself through the chest instead of anything. And it took him 3 days to die. And when his brother had said, please let me help you, he said, this sadness will last forever. And then he passed on.
So cool. And I love what you've done with the color there, because after his death, his bikinis, it took a while, but his paintings eventually became popular then.
Mm-hmm.
Very cool. This is amazing work. Mm-hmm. That's very well done.
And I wanted, as it to go on, the color to start draining from him.
Oh, I see what you've done.
And then finally, when he does it, you see all of his paintings and all that, and then it paints the field around him. And he actually painted the field that he shot himself in about 2 weeks prior.
Oh, that's incredible. If you don't know much about Van Gogh at home, please go research it. Google him. There's documentaries about his work. Check that out for sure. Okay, we got one more piece here before we go into, I think one or two, before we go into our actual sketching phase. So tell us, this is a pencil reference drawing. So.
I did this for a scholarship that I got, which was great.
Oh, cool.
And we had to do a still life. They wanted a still life. And I was allowed to set up anything that I had in the house. Do not panic. It's not a real skull. His name is Hamlet. His name is Hamlet, and he was given by a friend.
Yeah, I'm glad you explained that.
Yeah, he's not real. He looks very realistic, and he's very heavy, but he's not real.
Okay.
And I had some antlers, and I'd made a flower crown out of non-real flowers because they would have died. But I made that flower crown, and I sat it up, and I was like, oh, this is going to be so much fun. And then I got started drawing it, and I'm like, this is the worst mistake I've made in my life.
Takes a lot of time, right?
Oh, yeah, the flowers, I thought I was just going to, like, throw myself off a cliff afterwards.
So as you can see at home, I chose Katie for a very special reason. She has tons of talent, scholarship received with this piece.
Yeah.
So I know everybody's eager to see you actually draw, and you're going to actually be giving our lesson today, which is really cool, and I'm excited about that. And I'm actually going to move your work over here, okay? I'll be real careful, I promise. We're actually going to be following Katie's instruction today with our piece that we're going to be working on. So what we're going to be doing is actually a fawn creature, right? And you're going to be walking us through the steps of each one of these processes. So you at home, what I need you to do is go ahead, grab some paper, grab a pencil. What we're going to do is we're going to go through the general sketch of it together. She's going to walk us through that, and then we're going to speed color. And you're going to, what choice of color are you using today?
I'm using watercolor and all sorts of earth tones.
Okay, art pens, Copic markers, and watercolor, right?
Yeah.
Okay, so let's go ahead and get started. All right, so you can see we're both using pencil. This looks like a pen, but it's a pencil, both of us. So
it's a really good pencil. I would invest in it.
So I'm going to follow along with you, so
all
you
right,
go right
cool.
ahead.
So a lot of people that I know are just like, oh, just start drawing it. No, I'm not that technical. I have to do my little circle first.
Okay, so we talked in here a lot about circle methods. I'm using the circle method for drawing, so okay, keep going.
And I always, if I'm trying to figure out which direction the face is going to go, is where I will put my cross.
Okay, so center line of the face, right?
Yep.
Okay.
And a lot of people, when they want to draw the center line for the eyes, they put it like way up here in the middle of the circle, but in reality it's going to be a little bit lower.
All right. I'm following you.
I got you. And I will use this side right through here to figure out how the face is going to be shaped. So I know there's going to be kind of like forehead area and then a dip where the eyeball is. And then it's going to come down, and I'm going to check and make sure that's half and half. And that makes the chin.
Very cool. Okay.
Your eyes will always be half the distance of your face. And that's why I checked that.
Okay. Your eyes will be the half distance of your face. Okay.
Yep. And fawns that I draw, they don't have a normal human nose. They're very broad and very flatter, if that makes any sense.
Sure.
So I always make them a little bit bigger than what an actual human nose is.
Okay.
And they kind of, I don't go very in detail with the deer shape of the nose. I just kind of wing it.
Sure.
Looks more doggish, but it works.
Works real well. Okay.
And I don't get very into detail with the mouth either. I'll just do something like that.
Okay.
Just a little quick thing.
All right.
And I fill the eyes in how they should be, and where it's turned, I know one eye is not going to show completely, and the other one will.
Okay.
And these characters have very big doe eyes because, you know, they're part deer.
Right. Okay.
And I always add, like, a little crease to the lid. Their eyebrows, I don't know if you've ever seen a coon dog, but they got, like, the little fluff right there.
Sure, absolutely.
That's kind of what their eyebrows do.
Okay.
They've just got these little fluff of eyebrows.
All right, very cool. Okay, I'm tracking.
I got you.
You can keep going.
And this is going to be a winter scene, so I'm going to go ahead and add this fluff that they normally grow around their neck and shoulders and down their back, and that was one of my ideas. I always figured that they would shed in the summer and spring, but during autumn and winter they'd grow this mane type thing around their shoulders and neck to help keep them warm. And figure out the eyes, or not the eyes, but the ears. I kind of just go straight across. And I draw kind of like these big floppy deer ears.
Alright.
Nothing too fancy.
Okay.
And since most of my fawn characters, I'm just going to put that other ear over there. Since most of my fawn characters are in the wild, I give them kind of short hair, but not too short. But it's very curly. So I just kind of go around and I don't get too into details and just have some fun with it.
Very cool.
And then I add the horns, which are usually about that far. Mm-hmm. And they go up. And the horns I normally draw can either be really complex or they can be really simple.
Okay. All right.
And when I get stuff like that sketched out, I'll go through and I'll erase these lines because you don't really need them anymore.
Trying to
all fawns are unique. All
right.
But after I get the initial sketch, I will go through and just kind of maybe touch up some details if anything's out of line. And that's when I actually go into the process of inking, which I'm not going to take you all the way through because we ain't got time, but I did ink this one.
Mm-hmm.
To kind of show
very cool
what's going on with that. And that's when I actually start the watercolor.
Okay, this has just been very cool. I hope everybody at home has followed along and was able to create their own font. And as you said at the end, I appreciate that.
All fonts are unique.
Different. Yeah, unique, right? Okay, very cool. Katie, we're going to go ahead and start the coloring process.
Cool.
And this will be something that we're going to speed through as quickly as possible. Mm-hmm. And we're going to come back and close. So stay tuned for the coloring process. And so you can slow it down at home and try to follow along with us, okay? Here we go. All right, everybody, I hope you have enjoyed the coloring process. Katie, I cannot tell you how much we appreciate you coming in today.
It was very fun.
And you came all the way from Perry County just to participate.
Mm-hmm.
So thank you so much.
You're very welcome.
I want to show everybody just a quick overhead of what you finished before we close out. And I'm sure you had a chance to check this out already, but it's an amazing job, and you've done this in no time.
Hey, this is what a quick sketch would look like, just figuring out something.
Yeah, and I'll put my pitiful little take beside it. But you taught me. You taught me my first fawn. I've never
it's
drawn
beautiful.
A fawn.
So, no, well, give him a name, and it's official.
I think I'm going to name him Henry.
There you go. We got Henry and Lazarus.
All right, Henry and well. Lazarus right here. So thank you all so much for tuning in today. We really appreciate everyone's support, and we also want to thank The Holler, and we want to thank Pike TV for making this show possible and bringing this show to you. Before we go, I want to talk to Katie a little bit more. I want to give her a chance to thank anyone she'd like to thank, and also tell us a little bit about what your plans are after you graduate. So go ahead, the show's yours.
All right, so I'm going to thank some people first. I want to thank Lisa Holland and Melissa Brashear for dealing with me the past 4 years and probably going to have to deal with me the rest of their lives because I'm not letting them go. And I want to thank Linda Campbell, my aunt, and Ricky Campbell, my uncle, for also dealing with me the past 5 years after adopting me and enabling me to get all this good stuff to work with and pursuing my career. And thanks, Christina, for teaching me, and Katie Mice for dealing with me.
And also Sarah Howard.
And Sarah, yes, Sarah, yes. Thank you.
Yeah, absolutely. So
she did everything in her power to get me here.
Well, you have, see, I'm stumbling over my words.
You got this.
You're a prime example of the talent that we have here in Eastern Kentucky.
Thank you.
And it's untapped talent, in my opinion. And that's why this show exists, in part, is to bring you and show you, our viewers, just exactly the talent that's around us. So it means a lot for you tuning in. Support our local artists as much as you can and in any way possible. And if you had a good time today, please go on to theholler.org. Share some of your work with us. We'd love to see it. We'll show it here on the show. And until next time, keep drawing. Thank you.